I'm the son of a third generation farmer. I've been married 10 years to the farmer's daughter. I'm a God-fearing, hard-working combine driver, hogging up the road on my plower, chugga-lugga-lugging 5 miles an hour on my international harvester.
It's awesome. I love it. I look forward to this time of year. It is so much fun. We're gonna have a blast. Well, good morning, Mountain Rivers Church.
Good morning.
Good morning to our online family. And we just want to say good morning to our newcomers today. We're so glad to have you guys. And we have some really special things in store for you today.
That's right. But before we get into today's word, I just want you to listen up. What you just saw was our annual tracker poll. And some of you guys may say, that looks crazy and somewhat dangerous. It is so much
yes.
fun. That's happening this Wednesday night, April 13th. There's flyers all over your seats. Those are not just for you. Those are so you can go out and tell somebody else. Everybody repeat after me. Say, outreach.
Outreach.
Outreach. Say it again. Outreach.
Outreach.
You're not repeating, you're saying it at the same time.
I'm saying it at the same time.
Outreach.
Outreach. Wait.
Alright, here we go. Ready?
Ow.
You say it, I'll repeat after you. Okay?
Outreach.
Outreach. That's what I wanted you to do. Repeat after me. Outreach.
Outreach.
Thank you. This Wednesday night is not about us. Okay? Are we gonna have a blast? Yes.
Yes.
If you come out, you're gonna have so much fun, but it's about everybody else that's out here surrounding our community. It is an outreach. That means you take an invite out of your seat, you walk up to somebody and say, hey, are you looking to have a good time? Wednesday night, come out to Mountain Movers Church. We're having a lawn tractor pull. They say, what is that? It's where you take garden tractors and you pull a sled to see how far you can go. It's awesome. Just going to be cash prizes. So maybe you know somebody with tractors.
Right.
They can bring them.
Right.
Be here at 6:30 to get registered.
Right.
The event starts at 7.
Yes.
There's an echo. Maybe you say, well, I'm not gonna drive a tractor. That's okay. Come make fun of all those who do, because it is a lot of fun. We're going to have inflatable games for all the kids. They're going to have a blast. Free food. We're going to have backyard burgers and hot dogs and all the sides.
Right.
You make it hard to think.
I'm trying to help.
You are.
I'm just trying to.
You're just encouraging.
I'm encouraging. That's what I'm doing.
All right. Wednesday night, 7 o'clock. Make sure you're here.
What rednecks do you know that need Jesus? Right? Get out there and get
Most
the word
out.
Most of them. And so get them here. It's going to be awesome Wednesday night. Now, it's not an accident that you're here this morning. It's not. God is supernaturally drawing you to this place so that He can speak to the very inner being of your spirit, of your heart. He has something for you today. And so I would ask that we would position ourselves to listen, to learn, to walk away, to leave this place different than the way we came. If we leave the same, then our time has been in vain. Right? We should always, always, always come with an expectation, with an anticipation that God wants to speak to us. He has something to say to us through His powerful, life-changing word. This is our moment. This is the time of week where God is going to speak to us corporately, and I am really looking forward to God's word this morning. How about you guys?
Yeah.
We may be few in number. I don't know why we're few in number. I don't know why. The place has been packed the last couple weeks, but awesome. So that means, you know what? You have an opportunity. Every seat that you see that is empty is an opportunity to invite somebody that needs life change to come and sit around you next time. So go out and get them.
And hey, let me give you a challenge I don't think I've ever given you before. If you look around and you see somebody missing that you normally see somewhere near
sure.
you, text them and you go, I don't have their number. Facebook them. Send them a card. That's kind of outdated, but we do that sometimes here. Let them know you miss them. Because you know what? Sometimes we don't think to tell people. Like, we're super excited they're here, but when they're gone, we forget to just say, hey, we noticed you weren't here and we missed
right.
you.
Right.
All right, this morning we're going to pray. Bear your head with me. Father God, thank you so much, Lord, that you surround us in this place. God, if we were to come in here and your presence did not show up, God, it would be a complete waste of time. But God, I thank you that you are so faithful. God, that you are surrounding us in this place. God, that you do want to speak directly to each of us individually, right where we are right now. God, you're such a big God that you know every situation, every circumstance, every individual, God, and you care about them as a person. God, I pray today, open our hearts, God, to receive your word. Open our mind to be able to comprehend it and understand it. God, and help us to be willing today to apply your word to our life and let it bring change. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right, so on December 13th, 2007, there was this girl by the name of Sarah Smith, and she was arriving back into the States from New Delhi, India. All right, she came into O'Hare International. How many of you guys have ever been to O'Hare? It's a crazy, crazy big airport. And they've got this really cool, like, George Jetson four-level escalator. You just go hop on it, and it just takes you where you need to go. It's pretty cool. And so she landed there, and then she grabbed dinner, and then she grabbed a connecting flight to go home to San Francisco. So in a few weeks later, she was experiencing some really serious chest pains, and she sparked this really high fever, and then she started vomiting blood. It was a really, really bad deal. She got very, very sick. And she went to the doctor, went to the hospital, and they began running some tests. And they realized that she had some very, very rare case of tuberculosis. In fact, it was XDR-TB. And what this means is extensively drug-resistant tuberculosis. It was highly, highly contagious. Now, what's interesting about this story is that she knew that she had been exposed to this virus when she left New Delhi, India. And she came to the States because she wanted to come back home, she wanted to be with family, she wanted to be with her doctor at her hospital where she could be comfortable and really know that she was getting the care that she deserved. The problem with this is she was highly contagious. So when the hospital found out that she had done this, they contacted the Center for Disease Control. And they started doing the research, and they looked at every other passenger that would have been like within so many rows of her sitting on these planes, and there's no way they could have even began to find out what people she came into contact with while she was at the airport. I mean, it's just crazy, but the researchers went out there, and they just started making phone calls, and they found out that they had actually identified 44 people from 16 different states who were within two rows of Sarah on her flight, and they had been contaminated, and now they were dealing with this very, very rare and almost incurable form of tuberculosis. It was a nightmare, absolute nightmare. She knew that she was contagious the entire time, right? I mean, when you think about that, it's just crazy to think that somebody, I mean, contagions freak me out, right? It freaked me out, right? But like, I saw this study. This is so disgusting. I saw this study on 2020 one time. How many of you guys like documentaries? Yes? All right, awesome. Me too. So they did this study on public places and germs, contaminants, cross-contamination, all that kind of stuff. And they started swabbing these common public places like water fountains and door handles to businesses. Ew, so gross. They swabbed this one door handle in front of the business, and they recognized like over 20 different viruses, one of them being strep throat. They saw it was all right there under the door. They'll never go out in public again, I know. I'm totally freaking you out. I know, it's disgusting. And like when I go to Walmart, oh my word, right? How many of you guys have ever had sniffles or whatever, and you're at the doctor's and you're like, where did I get this? And he's like, Walmart, because you can get everything at Walmart. You can't get anything and everything at Walmart. That's why when I go in, right, I go into that little wipe dispenser deal, go, and I grab like 15 of them, and I just, hey, they're free, right? So then I just go, and I rub that across the top of the shopping cart just so I know that I'm not catching any of those 20 different viruses that are probably sitting on that handle. I know, it's disgusting. I know, I'm sorry. I hope that I haven't totally burned you out from going in public again. But today, we're talking about the word contagious. All right, everybody say contagious.
Contagious.
All right, but I hope you know, normally when we hear the word contagious, it gives us that negative connotation, probably because of the picture that I just painted.
Yes.
But I hope to change the way you think about contagious today. Misty and I hopefully will bring some enlightenment to the word, and hopefully you'll run with it in a different way.
That's right. So for the next 3 weeks, we're going to be in this series, Contagious, but we're going to look at it from a different angle than the nasty picture Brad painted. And there's not a better time than right after Easter to go into a series like this. You know, when we were in the Easter series, we did a series called Behind the Scene. So if you guys were here, and if you weren't, maybe you can look it up on YouTube. But what we did is we went back to the very beginning, and we asked the question, God, why? Why did you do all this? Why did you write this story? Why did you make this movie, if you will? Why did you do this? Why did you send your only son? Why did he willingly die? Why did you raise him from the dead? And there was one answer we gave you. There was one reason God did it all. All throughout the entire Bible, there's one reason God did it. Does anybody know what that reason is? One word.
Relationship.
You guys are good. You get an A.
Yes.
God did it all because he wanted a relationship with you. He wanted a relationship with me. And so as we go into this series today, what we're going to do is we're going to pick up where we left off with the resurrection. You know, on Easter we talked about how 3 days in the grave and then Jesus was gone. He resurrected. And the next 40 days were really significant. The next 40 days after the resurrection, Jesus spent time with his disciples. He spent time teaching them. Now remember, there's only 11. One has gone away. Judas hung himself after he betrayed Christ. And so these 11 guys are with Jesus, and he's trying to explain to them, okay guys, you saw everything up to now. And now, here's the rest of the story. I'm getting ready to leave. And they're like, no, don't go. Like, you just overcame death, hell, and the grave. Like, this is awesome. We're going to overthrow the Roman government. Still, they have that mentality. And Jesus is like, you don't understand. I have to go. And the reason I have to go is I'm just one person. I'm just a man, just like you right now. But if I go, then I'm going to send back the Holy Spirit. And he's going to come to live on the inside of you. Those of you who say, you know what? I believe in Jesus. I want him to come into my life. Forgive me of my sins. I believe. That means that no longer do you have to bring bulls and goats and all the junk we were doing before, but now you can have direct access to Almighty God. You want me to go. And of course, they couldn't quite wrap their brain around it, as many of us today. Have you ever asked yourself some of those tough questions like, where did God come from? You ever ask yourself that? I remember being a kid, and I've been in church, I've heard all the stories, heard the same teaching, and then think, but who created God? And you know what? There's some mysteries that we are never going to understand until we stand before God himself. My son asked that very question this week, and what do you say as a parent? Who created God? How did he get here? Son, he just always was. And a 13-year-old boy looks you in the face and says, that's not going to work for me. I need a better answer to that. And I'm like, you know what? Live your life right, and one day you'll stand before God and you can ask him how that just was. But these were where the disciples were, just kind of like, don't really understand, but okay, I'm just going to go with it. All right? So right before Jesus leaves, he's on these, we don't know exactly what day it was, but leading up to his last day here, he comes out to these guys and he begins to tell a group of people, he says, listen to me, I completed my mission. I did what I came to do. I finished my task. Now I'm going to pass the baton. Has anybody ever ran a race, like one of those relays? You ever seen it? Some of you guys are track people. And you know how they take the baton and you guys line up. I'm just going to borrow it. I'll give it back in a minute. And you line up, right? And you run the whole time with that baton. And then when you get back to that same spot, you pass it off. You can take it. You pass it off. And off goes the next guy or the next girl.
That's my form.
That was nice.
Thank you.
And Jesus was doing the same thing. He was like, listen to me. I already ran my laps. I did what I came to do. Now I'm giving it to you, boys and girls. And he gives us what we call the Great commission. Some of you guys may have heard of this. And I want you to think for just a second, what does the word commission mean? That word commission means he's giving you instructions. What's instructions? Something we're supposed to follow. Or a command. Or a duty given to a person or a group of people. So he lays this out. He says, okay, here's what it is. The Great Commission. If you've got your word, go with me to Matthew chapter 28.
You have a mic.
No wonder
yes.
It's so loud.
This is much better.
It is set different for me. They turned me down.
I can say something real quick. It's really awesome. So, constantly advancing, we have the best audio video team on the planet. They're amazing.
That's true.
And so they have, don't look, because this is like, don't look at the man behind the curtain kind of stuff, but they're on the back wall, don't look, on the back wall, there they have this new set of doors. It has the, don't look, it has the scriptures for us, the next scripture coming up, and then they can send us messages like we have right now at the very bottom, don't look. It says, you have Brad's mic. That's awesome. Okay, I'm going to tell you another message. They sent me one time when we had this on a different system, but promise me you won't tell anybody, okay?
Right.
Okay. So, honest, this is the reality of ministry, people. I'm telling you the truth. So, one of the AV guys comes downstairs, and they're in this doorway while we're teaching. I'm sitting here teaching. I get distracted really, really easy. And this guy is over here, and he's like,
trying to start a lawnmower?
What's he doing? And I keep looking back at him. I'm sitting here trying to teach him. He's like, on earth? And then he goes, I look down at the screen, it says, Pastor Brad, your fly is down. Like, the disciples were, and we're back in this. I had this pair of jeans that the fly just, and it just had this automatic release on it, just, and it just flew down. And I got rid of those jeans. Because I preached the entire message that day with my fly down. It was a bit embarrassing, to say the least. But you took an oath this morning. You will not tell anybody.
Right. You know, sometimes our amazing volunteers have to do things that they normally wouldn't do just for the betterment of the message. That's right. All right. Go to Matthew.
I'm going to check my phone.
Chapter 28. Now we service. Matthew 28. We're going to start at verse 19. It says this. Therefore, got to stop. If you have ever studied the Word of God, you've heard us say this before, and that is when you see the word therefore, you cannot understand what you're about to read unless you go back and read the passage before it. That's why you see therefore, based on what has already been stated. So let's go back one, and we're going to go back to verse 18 and understand why did he say therefore. Now remember, this is Jesus talking, and he gives this commission. He says, Jesus told his disciples, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. I want you to just pause for a minute and think about this. Jesus is saying, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Why did he say he's been given all authority on earth? You know, the Bible says that the enemy, Satan, who was kicked out of heaven, is the prince of the air. But Jesus is now saying, I have all authority in heaven and now on earth. Let me tell you why. Because when he overcame death, hell, and the grave, and he rose again, he now had authority on earth. All right? So he's saying, listen to me. Because I have been given all authority everywhere, from heaven to earth, I am now giving you this new mandate. I'm passing off that baton, and he says this. Go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I've given you, and be sure of this. I am with you always, even to the end of the age. I love taking a scripture and studying it and really understanding what every word means. And whoever was speaking it, what was the context in which it was being spoke? And this was Jesus himself. And when you look at that word, go, That word is not just an action word, although it's a verb, and it literally means you're going to have to do something, right? I mean, if you line up to race, and you've got a group of kids, and you scream, go, what do you think they're going to do? They're going to run. They're going to take off. It's Kids Ministry 101, right? Things get out of control, like just play a game, scream, go, and they're all having a blast. Well, Jesus, when he did this, he was saying, listen, I'm asking you to do something. You're not just going to stand here, but I want you to engage. I want you to actually do something. The second part he said, go and make. Let me back up. How many of you guys are going to go somewhere today? Yeah. Well, I hope you are. Otherwise, you're staying here with me, right? And I'm leaving later on, too. You're going to go places. Jesus was literally saying, and this word go literally means as you are going. If you don't mind writing in your Bible, you should write it down and never forget it.
Right.
He wasn't saying, I'm going to call you to Africa, and I'm going to call you to China, and I'm going to call you to, you know, New Guinea or wherever. He was saying, listen to me, you're all going to go somewhere. So as you are going, make disciples. Make disciples. What does make mean? Again, it's an action word. It means you're actually going to do something. If you're going to go make some chocolate chip cookies, what are you going to do? You're going to have to put all the ingredients into the bowl. You're going to have to mix it up, right? It's going to take some effort on your part. Jesus was saying, I want you to put forth some effort. I want you to go make disciples. And what is a disciple? It's a big word. It's a churchy word. It simply means a follower of Jesus Christ. You ever play that game, follow the leader? Right? I love being the leader. I was like, oh, you're just right here. I will be the leader. Some of you guys know me. You can imagine why, right? I love that game. But it's kind of that way. Jesus says, listen, we're going to play follow the leader. I'm the leader. You're going to follow me. And I want you to go out and I want you to find more people to get in the game and follow you as you follow me.
One of the things that Jesus instructed them to do as part of this commission is to baptize people. Wherever they went, the church would be baptizing people in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And in short, you know, when we think of baptism, I think a lot of times we just see this picture of like halfway drowning somebody in the water and like making them confess Jesus as Lord, and it's almost like a, you know, you're kind of like, we can't, and confess Jesus. No, but really, you know, the meaning behind baptism is really about initiation. And, you know, for those of us that know anything about like a gang, you know, there is a point of initiation where if you want to be in this gang, you know, in many cases what they do is they just beat the daylights out of somebody, and if they can get up, then they're in. And they say, if you try to leave this gang, the same thing is going to happen to you if you try to leave. So, but the reason they go through that initiation is it's a public announcement saying, you know what, I'm being initiated into this family, right? And that's really what baptism is it saying, I'm telling the world that I'm leaving my old life and I'm starting a new life and I'm joining the family of God. And it's so cool when you think of it that way, because you're like, you're just telling the whole world, man, I'm done with the old me. The old things are passed away. All things become new. And you're just making that announcement to the world, saying, man, I am ready to live for God, and I'm proud. I'm living it loud and proud. I'm going public with this. And it's just, it's exciting to see. And we love, that's one of our favorite things that we do, is baptizing people down here at the lake. Not far from here. We just love seeing life change happen there in the water. And so that's part of this great commission. That's really one of the driving forces behind what we do at Mountain Movers Church, is we love to see people go public with their faith and get baptized. The next thing he said is, teach these people to observe all that I have commanded, right? And that is his word. It's not Misty's responsibility and my responsibility solely to share the things of God and the Word of God with others. It's all of us. It's all of us in this, sharing the excitement of God's Word. Where it's living, it's breathing, it's active, it's life-changing. It is exciting if you can just develop a hunger and a longing for God's word in your life, I'm telling you, you'll never be the same again. And it is contagious. I'm telling you, it's contagious. All right, Brad moment. So speaking of contagious, I got to tell you this story. Okay, I have to tell you this story. This morning, all right, she made me promise that I would not say this in church. I'm going to do it anyway. So we're in the office early this morning, mute her mic. We're in the office and we are preparing, right? And I'm telling you, the last couple weeks, who does the inventory for the move?
My mom.
Okay, so she changed up the inventory, right? Normally, we've got candy bars and chips and stuff, and a new candy bar arrived in the move last week, and my eyes have been on it, and I've not been able to peel my eyes off. It looked really good. I've never had one. Has anybody ever heard of a Caramello bar? Caramello? Is that how you say it? Caramello? Oh, yeah. Man, that's right. Yeah. Yummy. I'm going to make that two words. Dude, so it's been calling my name. I can hear it. I don't know if it was the Holy Spirit or what it was, but it was calling. It was saying, Brad, come over here and eat me. So I took it up on the challenge. And this morning, I took it to the office, and I started peeling that dude back with a hot cup of coffee, right? So I'm sitting down next to my beautiful bride. Let me give you a little bit of background. I'm going to make it spiritual, so don't worry about it, all right? So I'm sitting next to my beautiful wife, who, here's a little bit of background, she is a sissy, absolute sissy, when it comes to tasting or trying anything new. She is so boring. She doesn't like adventure. She is just every, I'm sorry, that's soapbox. Can I stand on this? I'm going to stand. Oh, did I kill myself? Soapbox, okay. Is everybody listening? I haven't eaten Chinese since we got married. You want to know why? Because she's boring. And every time we go out on a date night, we go to the same Mexican restaurant in Grove. Every single time, she is boring. And every single date night, the same thing happens over and over. Hey, honey, would you like to try something new? How about we try a Chinese restaurant? She's like, oh, no, gross. Let's go to Manchuria again. I'm like, mister, can we please? And not only that, when we
you
go,
know you're gonna like
I thought you were going to mute her mic. Apparently, we didn't get the word across. Mute the mic. We eat the same dish, the same order every time. We get especial Mexico Viejo fajitas. They are good. They got shrimp and chorizo and chicken. It's good. But it's boring because we eat the same thing every single time.
You're making me hungry.
No adventure whatsoever. She says, I made this breakfast shake. We do these protein shakes, these health shakes, every single day, all right? And I made a really good one yesterday. And I'm like, honey, you gotta try this. And when she sips something that she doesn't want any part of, she goes like this.
It's just not on the right thing.
Yeah. She goes. Oh, no, I don't like that. No. So that's her, okay? No adventure, she's a sissy, she's boring. So I have this Caramello bar, and I'm like, honey, this. I was already like two squares into it, and I'm like, this is really good. You've got to try this. And the caramel is drizzling down. I mean, it's pouring, oozing out of the next square that was about to get hammered, right? And I'm like, honey, it's running out. You've got to try this. This is really good with a little bit of coffee. And so I put the bar up to her, and she's like, and she like makes out with it. And then she sits back and she's like, no, I don't want it. And I'm sitting here holding it. She licked
all the caramel. You be quiet.
She licked all the caramel. I mean, she.
I know I like caramel.
Licked the whole thing. I'm like, are you done? Are you good? You just licked that thing half to death. And you're gonna hand it to me. And she's like, no, I don't want it. Have you been contagious?
Oh, yeah.
I'm like, eat the next square. Just eat it. Do it a favor. You've already melted half the thing with the temperature off your tongue. Eat that square. Do us all a favor. So I ate. So whatever she had, I hope it's not contagious. You're right.
Actually, I
my
sorry, I had to tell that story.
You were in the middle of what you were teaching.
Oh yeah, so teaching and to observe everything that God has commanded us in His Word. His Word is contagious, and God calls us through the Great Commission to be contagious with His Word and the things He's done in our lives. Okay, but check this out. When Jesus was on this earth for that time period of 40 days, so many crazy things happened. In fact, there were so many miracles that happened during that time that they couldn't even record everything.
That's right.
So many wonderful things. Can you imagine being there during that time and being with Jesus, hanging out with Jesus, watching Him perform these miracles and just being in it? So awesome. But at the culmination of this time frame, this amazing event transpires. An amazing event right before the disciples' eyes as He ascends into heaven.
That's right. Go over, if you're in Matthew, flip a couple over, and you're going to go to Acts. But we're going to look at Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 11. This is where what's called the ascension. It's one of the six most important parts of the entire Word of God. But I'm going to start at verse 6, and it says this. So when the apostles, that's also just another word for disciples. An apostle was somebody who started a new work, okay? So these followers of Christ were starting a work, so here it calls them apostles. When they were with Jesus, they kept asking Him, Lord, has the time come for You to free Israel and restore our kingdom? If you were here during our series for Easter, we were talking about a lot how they didn't understand why He came and they wanted Jesus. They thought He was coming to overthrow the Roman government. And here, right before He leaves, they're asking the same question. All right, is it go time? Are you going to overthrow the Roman government and free all of Israel? And He tells them this. The Father alone has the authority to set those dates and those times. They are not for you to know. But, listen to this, underline it, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be My witnesses, telling people about Me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. After saying this, He was taken up, this is Jesus, He was taken up in the clouds while they were watching. They could no longer see Him. And as they strained to see Him rising into the heavens, two white-robed men suddenly were standing there. And He said, Men of Galilee, why are you standing here staring into heaven? Jesus has been taken from you into heaven. Listen to this. But someday, He will return from heaven in the same way you just saw Him go. Someday, He's going to come back the same way He left. He ascended into the heavens. In just a moment, He was gone. And He said He's going to come back that same way. Do you realize that someday could be today?
Yeah, I love that. You know, guys, there's a lot of things that we get excited about at Mountain Movers Church on a regular basis. All right? There's a lot of things. I love that we're really blessed with a great worship band. That's exciting. That's great. You know, Misty and I love having fun up here teaching the Word. We hope that people enjoy it. You know, it's exciting to add on to our foyer, and it's exciting to do this tractor pull, these big events. There's a lot of things that we get excited about, these things that we celebrate on a regular basis. But let me tell you what drives us. At the end of the day, when all the smoke clears, all the fun and all the excitement, everything that we normally celebrate, here's really, really what drives us. As we're fulfilling the Great Commission in this church, we're seeing lives change. We are driven by something that is bigger and greater than ourselves. And the mission of this church is to lead people into a real and life-changing relationship with Jesus that is contagious. And we see that before our own eyes. Each and every week, as pastors, we get to see all the wonderful life change happening around us. Guys, it's real. It's real. It doesn't have anything to do with the music. It doesn't have anything to do with the building or the events or anything like that. It has everything to do with the fact that God's presence and His power is real in this place. We love doing our newcomers life group on Wednesday nights because we get to hang out with people who are brand new to Mountain Rivers Church. We get to know them personally. And they get to hear about our church. And we get to hear their stories. Like the The favorite question that we like to ask is, what made you decide to make Mountain Rivers Church your home? You would not believe the stories that we hear. Or when we ask, how did you hear about Mountain Rivers Church? Almost every time, it was someone in this church that was contagious, that got a hold of them at work, or a family member, or they were a neighbor, or a friend. It's amazing. And then they come in this place, and you just see the tears streaming down their face, and they're like, I never thought church could be like this. I've never really, really realized that I could have a relationship, a real relationship with God. I mean, how powerful is that? I love it. So that drives us. We have the most amazing leaders in this church and the most amazing serve team, volunteers, that show up week in and week out doing what they do. You see them, they're out by the road with their crazy signs. People think they're like high on some sort of like legal stimulant or something. I don't know, but like they're crazy. They've got energy and they're loving people. And there's people greeting you on the sidewalks and serving coffee and donuts. And people up in the AV room and running cameras and the band up here. There's all this stuff going on. These amazing teachers and the kids crew and nursery. I mean, they do what they do every week, not because of a building project or because of a tractor pull or because of the free food Wednesday night or because of these pastors or because of anything else but this. They do it because they are impacting and changing lives for all of eternity. We are rescuing people from hell and helping them to make heaven their home. There's nothing greater than knowing that all of us have played some part in making an eternal difference in the lives of others. I love it. We're driven by it. It's addictive. It's contagious. It's contagious. You know, I really love building a fire. My boys and I love to build fires. All right, they like to build fires when Dad's not home and burn stuff they shouldn't be burning. But we love building a fire. And I've taught them that when you build a fire, you have to start by gathering together those things that are dead and dry, like leaves and twigs and you know, branches and dead grass. Anything that you can get that is dead and dry and brittle, all it takes really is just a very little spark of a flame to ignite the beginning stages of that fire. And once you get it going, you can just add things to that fire. Just make the sticks a little bit bigger and work your way up to a log, and you've got fire happening, right? But it doesn't happen without beginning with those things that are dead and dry, brittle, and just letting that little spark of a flame ignite that fire. And I want to tell you this morning, there are people that God has strategically placed in your life. Please listen to me. He has strategically placed people in your world who are dead and dry, brittle, they're broken. And all it's going to take to see the flame of God ignited in their life is if you just get close enough to them. So that spark, that flame, can just ignite their life. All it takes is somebody like you that's on fire for God to just get up in their world and show them the love of Christ. It's not about judging people. It's not about criticizing them. It's about loving them. And you may not know what to say in that moment. Don't worry about that. The Bible says when the time comes, in that moment, you will not need to know what to say, for the Holy Spirit will fill your mouth with the words to say in that moment, to say what you need to say. It might just be something as simple as saying, you know what? I know you're going through a really hard time. I love you, and I'm praying for you. And I may not have all the answers. I may not hold all the answers, but I'm holding on to the one who knows. Take those invite cards and you just get them here and let God's presence and power take over in their lives. I'm telling you, God wants you to be contagious. He wants you to be on fire for Him. Listen to this scripture, James 4:8 says, draw near to God
and he will draw near to you. Don't you understand? God is giving us this challenge. The Great Commission wasn't for Misty and I to fulfill. It was for all of us in this room. God is calling and drawing you and me to fulfill that commission, to lead people into a real and life-changing relationship with Him. We're not here to just breathe in air and make money and build up awards and accolades to have for ourselves. We are here to have a relationship with God, to know Him, and to make Him known. That is why we are here. If the second you got saved, if that's all that needed to happen in order for you to go to heaven, you would have been raptured in that second. But the fact that you're still here means that God still has a plan for you. And it's not to just do life to please yourself. It's not about us. Do you understand that? It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about them. It's about the dead, dry people that are hurting and helpless and hopeless in our world that we can touch with the contagions of Christ. Draw them in. Set their hearts on fire. And if we set them on fire, do you not know that they will rub shoulders with people in their lives that are dead and dry and dying? And they will set them on fire, and they will set their friends on fire, and they will set their friends on fire. Before you know it, I believe beyond the shadow of a doubt that Mount Movers Church is called to start a wildfire that cannot be contained, it cannot be extinguished, a fire that cannot be put out by the demons of hell, by the forces of darkness. God has a plan to impact the world, a global difference with a local church. A global difference with the local church. That doesn't happen with Misty and I. That happens with you. You can do it. You can do it. And it starts today. It starts right now. Will you stand up with me? How many of you in this place would say, Pastor Brad, I want my heart to be set on fire for God. And I want to set on fire those around me. Amen? Amen? Anybody else this morning? Anybody else be honest and just say, I want God to set my heart on fire? Amen? Amen? Yeah. Don't let this moment pass you by. This is not a joke. God wants to use you to touch somebody for eternity. Would you bow your heads? I want to pray for you right now. In Jesus' name, God, we thank you for your glory. We thank you for your power. May our cups be filled to overflowing. God, that what is running out will touch, contaminate, impact, affect others' lives for all of eternity. Set that spark, set that flame through our lives, Father God, that as we come into contact with those that are dead and dry, that their hearts would be set on fire for you, Father God, that they would see something in us that they want to catch, and that, God, you would set a fire from this church, that we would see lives continually set ablaze for your glory, that we would touch people for eternity. God, use us in this mighty way. Give us a hunger for your presence and an obsession with your word that cannot be satisfied. So hungry, so on fire, that we change our world around us. Help us to be contagious.
Still close. Maybe you would say to yourself, I can't set anybody else on fire because I myself am not on fire. Maybe you once were. Maybe you once made a commitment to Christ. But you know, if you don't keep the fire going, if you don't feed a fire, it eventually goes out. And maybe this morning you would say, you know what? I want to have a relationship with Christ that is really on fire. I want a real life-changing relationship, not just a one-time prayer. I want a life-changing relationship. You can have that today. It's the greatest thing that we ever do is making a decision to all out, wholeheartedly give our lives to Jesus Christ. And I want to tell you this morning, it's as easy as simply admitting that you are a sinner in need of a Savior. The Bible says we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But Jesus Christ came and he gave his life for sinners like me and like you. We can simply admit that we are sinners, believe on Jesus Christ, ask Him to come into our life and forgive us of our sins, and then start living for Him. Start getting into your Word and start learning, and you'll begin a little tiny flame. And that little tiny flame, the more you get into God's Word, the more that flame will build, and it'll build, and it'll build, until you become that contagious person that Jesus was talking about. This morning, if that's you, we are not going to embarrass you. We just want you to pray right where you are. As your pastors, we want to know who we're praying with. If you say, that's me, I want to be set on fire, I want that real relationship with Jesus, will you just throw your hands in the air when I count to three? Life change on three. One, two, three. Is that you? Amen. Hands go up everywhere. Thank you, Jesus. God, I thank you, Father God, for these lives. Will you just repeat this prayer after us this morning? Say, Father God.
Father God.
That I have fallen away from you. And I want a real relationship.
I want an authentic relationship.
I want to be set on fire. God, come into my life. Forgive me of my sins. I want to be contagious. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thanks so much for joining us today. If you want to be a part of something bigger than yourself, give to our ministry. We've made giving easy here at Mount Movers Church. If you have your smartphone, just text the number 918-223-8090. Just push in the amount you want to give and push send. It's that easy. If you don't have your smartphone, not a problem. You can mail your giving just as easy to 24,000 South 660 Road, Grove, Oklahoma, 74344. Thanks for watching today. Hey, remember, we're dreaming big for you. We'll see you next week.